What's up, my friends? Hope you're doing fantastic. I know this is a little different setup than normal, but I'm about to restart the Scott McKenna podcast, and I really want to take it seriously and do some things that I've never done before, and I want to get it going again. So if you've never listened to my podcast, I really hope that you can. There's a link below. Subscribe to it and listen, because I really hope exciting things are going to come. But I'm actually going to record a whole episode just kind of updating some things about life, some things that are happening, and then talk a little bit about gear and talk a little bit about tech and a lot of stuff that I want to start covering more on this channel. So, I'm about to do that. I figured why not just let the camera roll and just record a podcast. So we're going to get into it. If you are watching on YouTube, there will be a lot of B-roll that's over top of everything that I'm talking about, so hopefully it'll be more exciting to watch on YouTube than just being audio and me sitting at the microphone, but for now, it's just me at the microphone. Let's get into it. What's up, my friends? Welcome back to another episode of the Scott McKenna Podcast. I am so excited to finally be recording another episode. This whole COVID thing has everyone like just all thrown off, me more than anyone, and I'm getting the Scaling Creative Podcast up and running again, and I want to restart the Scott McKenna Podcast because there are so many things that I feel like I'm missing out on by not having more podcasts and being able to have more long-form conversations with you guys. So I'm back. And I'm going to start taking this more seriously. I'm going to start doing a lot more things on the podcast that I don't do on my YouTube channel. And this is one of them, just a little bit more of a deep dive. This is going to be partially like a life update, a little bit about what's going on. But then I do want to talk about some tech stuff. I want to talk about a huge mistake that I made this week that I will share more about. Has to do with my YouTube channel. And I'm also going to talk a little bit about tech, about some of the recent videos that I released, as well as the R5, the A7S III, the Blackmagic 12K, all these new things coming out that are just wow. So I'm going to get into a little bit of everything, but thanks for being here. I'm excited to get this started, and let's do it. So I want to start by just doing a little bit of an update, because it's been months since I've actually released a legit podcast. The last ones, couple ones that I released were more of the Q&As that I've been doing on Zoom. I've been trying to do that more often, because one of the unique things about posting videos on YouTube is you see a lot of comments and you see a lot of names consistently, but you don't get a chance to really put faces to people. So I've been trying to find more time recently to hop on every once in a while on YouTube Live and do these live Zoom Q&As where I bring people on a Zoom call, then I talk with them, answer some questions, get a chance to just put some faces to some names that I'm familiar with. And it's been a lot of fun, and from what I've gathered, people have gotten a lot of value out of them. It's been kind of a cool thing to do. Obviously, I do a lot of one-on-one consulting, like off of YouTube, but it's been cool to kind of bring a little bit of that to the YouTube Live platform. So that's been really fun. I've been trying to do that more often. If you haven't got a chance to check any of them out, I highly suggest that you go on the YouTube channel and look at some of them. And if you haven't listened to them, you can obviously listen to them on the podcast as well. But let's talk a little bit about life, right? Life has been very interesting, to say the least. I think everyone would agree that obviously we are in crazy times. And I hate even saying that anymore. I'm really sick and tired of actually saying that personally, because I feel like that's what everyone says. Like if I hear another person say unprecedented times, I'm probably going to go crazy. But we are definitely going through some interesting times. And one of the things that I think has been most interesting and probably the most difficult for me over the course of these last bunch of months have been the fact that my brain is just, it feels more all over the place than it ever has before. So if you follow my content for a while, you know that obviously my brain, I do a lot of different things and I try to keep things fresh and I constantly change things and I add things and change things around. And I just am always doing something different. But I've done so many different things over the course of the last couple of months, and from working from home, which kind of energized me into getting more into music, which then kind of took my focus off of video a little bit, and I kind of was all over the place with that. And then I kind of got the passion for music again, but then I somewhat lost some passion for music again, and then I went back into the video. And I feel, I don't know if you kind of are with me on this, but I feel like it's just been really, really hard for me to focus lately. Like I feel like I'm just constantly in this questioning phase where I'm just like, what do I really feel like doing? There are times that I feel so incredibly fired up about video and about content and about different things. And then there are other times that I just kind of feel sick of like the whole video production world and client work and all that, and feel like I just want to take YouTube more seriously. And then there are times that video and all that stuff doesn't seem exciting at all, and I want to just take, you know, music more seriously. And then I do music for a bunch of times and I realize that I kind of want to do some more video again. And then I do stuff at the church and I miss that at certain aspects. And I just feel like I'm just all over the place right now. And it's a little bit frustrating because I feel like it's very hard for me to focus on what's at hand, because every single time I'm doing something, I feel like I'm really questioning myself. Like, do I really want to be doing this? Am I enjoying this? Am I having fun? And I kind of got to the point maybe about a month ago or so where I realized that I wasn't really having a ton of fun in my everyday life. Like, I like what I do and I enjoy obviously video production and client work and all that, but I realized that I just wasn't having as much fun as I used to. And I realized that so much of it has been that I kind of went into getting out of my full-time job at the church years ago because I kind of wanted more freedom to do a little bit more of what I wanted to and work on what I wanted to and travel and hang out with the family and do all that kind of stuff. But then I realized, you know, as most people do, that when you own a business, you basically work even more than you did previously. And that's totally okay because I really do enjoy what I do. But I also realize that if I'm being honest, there are so many times that I have turned down playing golf or turned down playing disc golf or turned down doing something fun because I kind of almost have like this guilty feeling of I don't want to be that boss that goes out and has fun while his employees work, or I don't want to be that person on YouTube that talks about hustle and talks about how hard you have to work, and yet I just can relax and enjoy myself every once in a while. But then recently, you know, I kind of got mad at myself because I kind of realized like it's a really stupid mentality. Like, I worked really hard to get to where I'm at today, to be able to make enough money to have employees and be able to make enough money that I can enjoy some more things in life. And I'm not rich by any means, but I'm doing well and I love life and I should get to enjoy it a little bit more. And so I realized, you know, like a month ago, that I just want to do more things that aren't work. Like, I want to actually enjoy and be able to enjoy taking time off and actually having time with family or taking a random day off and playing golf just because. And I'm really going to start to try to do that more, and not because I want to be this person that doesn't ever work, because I really do enjoy what I do. But I realize that if I spend all of my time golfing or all of my time working, I'm sorry, I'm thinking about golf right now. If I spend all of my time working and never spend any time on myself, I'm going to burn out. Or more importantly, I'm just going to realize that I don't really like, you know, the phase that I'm going through. And I really want to enjoy life more. I want to enjoy life because I can, because of the fact that I have so many freedoms with my time to do kind of what I want. So I just have been a little bit all over the place where I kind of bounce back and forth between liking something and then not liking something and then wanting to do something different and doing something different and then realizing that I end up frustrating myself even more in that, because I end up looking at it and being like, I'm so all over the place that I feel like I'm not actually getting anything done. I find it hard to focus on things. So I've been working really hard recently on kind of what that means and how to kind of unpack that a little bit more so that I can be in the best place that I need to be for my business and in life in general. So if you can relate to any of that kind of stuff, shoot me a message. I would love to just know that you kind of are in the same realm. Part of the difficulty of being an entrepreneur is just the loneliness, the side of like a lot of people can't really relate to you if they aren't owning their own business, because there's just so many aspects of owning your own business that you don't really understand until you actually are in them. So it's kind of what I've been going through, and hopefully I feel like I'm getting my way out of it by being excited again about some of the stuff I want to work on. And I've actually decided to enter into a golf tournament later this month in September, one that's a pretty big amateur tournament, one that I played in a few years ago, and it's kind of forced me to have to go play and have to go to the range and have to take the game seriously again, which has actually been fun because I started taking golf lessons again, which I haven't done in years, just to make myself competitive. And even just the idea of the competition and practicing and getting on the range and all that has made me get excited about like doing something other than just work. So yeah, that's what I'm kind of doing right now, and I'm going to take it pretty seriously. So anyway, that's a little bit of an update. Business is going well. It's finally starting to kick back into gear, which is really good. Obviously, COVID feels like it never ends, and it never has, and it still hasn't. But business is finally feeling like it's starting to get busy again. We're starting to pick up a couple of new clients, starting to do more work with the clients that we were doing with. And so all that's really good. I'm not going to bore you with all those details, but everything's been on the up much more than it has been on the down. So I'm excited about that and thankful for that. Hopefully, if you run a business, you're feeling the same way. And I hope that we can support each other in that ever growing knowledge of just the difficulties of the up and downs of the entrepreneurial life. I just recorded a podcast on the Scaling Creative Podcast about the entrepreneurial roller coaster with another entrepreneur. And it's always good talking with people that are going through some of the same things because, man, this is not always easy for sure. So anyway, one of the things that I want to start on my podcast, and I won't start every podcast at all with like a life update because we won't have to do that. But one of the things that I do want to talk about at the start of each podcast, and try to keep it as brief as possible, but a little bit about like the videos that I recently released. So my goal would be to start to do these podcasts once a week. And it would be cool to start each episode with maybe 5 minutes of kind of some videos that I released this week. Obviously, with YouTube, no matter how many subscribers you have, not everyone sees the videos you post. And there's actually people that will probably listen to this podcast that don't also realize that I posted a video about this or a video about that. So I want to kind of briefly talk about the videos that I released, maybe touch on some things that didn't catch or didn't make it into the video and be able to just kind of update you on that. So video I released last week, and kind of thinking about, you know, the last week per se. And before I talk actually about the videos I released, let's talk about a bad thing that happened, the videos that I deleted. So I accidentally, about a week ago, was on YouTube and I was uploading a video and it got like an error in the upload. So if you're familiar with YouTube and uploading stuff on YouTube, on the back end side of YouTube Studio, you have like these check boxes where you can check a video and then you can hit, you know, delete or whatever you want to do with it or move it to a playlist or mark it as whatever. And I swore that I just checked that one video and I clicked up top and hit delete. And it said, "Are you sure you want to delete it? When you do that, it's going to delete it forever." And I said, "Yeah, that's fine." I didn't realize that apparently, which I still don't really think I did, but apparently I did. I checked the select all and it did it on the entire page of videos. So I think each page typically has like 25 videos, maybe 35 videos before it goes to page two or page three. And I apparently selected select all and hit delete. And then I was going to upload the video again, and I uploaded the video again, and I was like, why in the world is the last video that it's showing one about my 50,000 subscribers in the video that I posted back in January or eight months ago? And I realized that I had actually deleted all of my YouTube videos from the last 6-7 months, like all of them. And honestly, like, I don't really even care that much about views and all that kind of stuff. So at the end of the day, like, I have all the videos. I could have re-uploaded them, all that kind of stuff. Really, the only thing that was actually really scary was three of the videos that I deleted were actually sponsored videos. And if you know me, you know I don't do a lot of sponsored content on my channel because it just hasn't really been something that I've done on a regular basis. But I recently signed like a 5-video contract with a company, Clean My Mac X, great company. And so I had 3 videos up there already that I did for them and they were all gone. So obviously, yes, I could re-upload them, but there are sides of if one video is doing well and it starts to have a good search algorithm for certain topics and things, it can do better and can continue to do better. And I deleted them all. And I also had a video, one of my most successful videos on my channel now about using the Canon camera as your webcam, which was so funny because I just randomly uploaded that because I figured it would be helpful to people. And it ended up now it's like the third or fourth highest viewed video on my channel. It has like almost 200,000 views and it has like a crazy high CPM in terms of like the money that I make on the video, which is so odd. And it proves my point all the time of like not overthinking what you put out, because you never know what you put out could end up being the best video you have. Anyway, all those videos were gone, all of them. So even just re-uploading the video wouldn't have solved the issue, because a video like that that was doing so well, you don't really want to just start over, because it's not that easy. You don't just upload it again. You're like, my bad. And then it puts it right back into that search algorithm. It's not at all that way. So I was super bummed. So I tweeted out right away, hey, I just accidentally deleted all my videos. What should I do? And I tagged a couple of people that I figured might know. And everybody was kind of like, yeah, unfortunately, that's one of the crappy parts about YouTube, and there's just no way to get it back. And even YouTube creators, the actual Twitter handle from YouTube creators responded back and was like, hey, we really apologize. We're not able to do anything. And so I was like, that's definitely not good. So I reached out right away to YouTube. This was all in about 15 minutes. I reached out to YouTube in the YouTube chat. And luckily, I think I was early enough in the morning that there wasn't a lot of traffic in there, because I got someone on chat within 2 minutes and was like, hey, I just accidentally deleted my videos. And they were like, oh, no, which that's first thing they said. And I was like, oh, crap. But then they said to me, hey, we actually should be able to recover most of them because it happened so quick. And then they asked for all the links of the videos, which, like, I don't really know how I was supposed to get all the links to the videos. It turned out I just went in all my playlists and looked for all the deleted videos and kind of just gave them those links. And long story, I guess long, I got almost every one of the videos back except for like three. And they were vlogs and a couple of videos that weren't, I'm not going to re-upload because it just doesn't make sense now to upload those videos, because if they randomly come across people that watch my channel, they'll be like, what in the world? This video doesn't make sense right now. Because they were like early in March and April, whatever. So I was really excited about that, though. Almost all the videos got back. The videos about the Canon camera, all of them are doing well still. So that was really not fun at all. And I will not do that again. And now I make sure that I'm really careful deleting each video, because that was definitely not fun. Okay, videos I released this week. We'll make this quick. C200 lens setup was a video that I released late last week. And a quick update too, if you have been following my channel, you know that we recently, about a year ago, switched to the C200s as our main cameras. And I just actually bought my third one. I had posted this on Twitter and also on Instagram that one of our C200s had some sort of issue, and I actually had to send it back to Canon. And fortunately, they repaired it. I guess whatever was wrong with it, the sensor, whatever, and it's working great now. I got it back. It was not a super long process. It was all taken care of under warranty, so that was great. Super appreciate that. And I ended up also buying another one. I kind of still feel to this day, even in the last year and even over the last bunch of weeks and months, as new cameras have been introduced, which we're going to talk about, Canon R5, the A7S III, the Blackmagic 12K, all those videos, I still feel like for the work that we do, the C200s just are an outstanding camera. So I decided to just buy three of them and have three of them total. And now we use those for everything. We actually just shot a full wedding with the C200s last weekend, which was rare. But I just decided to try it because I felt like, hey, since I'm shooting a wedding, I may as well shoot it with the best cameras we have. So that was kind of fun. But so I talked all about the C200, the lens setup that we have, and talked a little bit about why we have each lens. So if you are interested in that video, definitely check that one out. It goes over every lens that we have and specifically why and when we use those lenses. So that video has done pretty well, actually, for my channel. I think people just like gear stuff. People are always just obsessed with gear, anything. I did the video 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, about how is the GH5 still relevant in 2020, and that video has done really well on my channel, and it's just funny how people just love gear stuff. So that video is up. And then today, as I'm recording this, which is Wednesday night, I released the F7 Fold LED review on the channel. So if you're unfamiliar with this light, it's basically a little foldable LED light that you can change all the color temperatures on, and you can change a little bit of the anything on the light, and it's a foldable light, so you can use either one light or two of them, and it has this honeycomb, it has a diffuser that you can put on. It's just a really, really cool light made by Falcon Eyes, and it's one that I've been using a ton because it's just really convenient when I don't have my big rigs with me. It's just nice to be able to have this little portable light that I can set up and use for a little bit of anything. It works great. It's like a little soft light on the face. It works good as a hair light. It works good as uplight in the background if you want a little bit of color. It's cool overall light, so I've been pretty happy with that, and I was excited to add that because now I kind of keep that attached to every single cinema bag that we have, so that when we just randomly go to a shoot and we suddenly need some light, we can, you know, use it and not have to have a lot of big lights and stuff that we have to carry around. So that's been a cool little addition to my rig that I've been pretty happy with for sure because it's nice to be able to have that when I need it. So those are the two videos I released this week. And to be honest, like, I'm really annoyed, frustrated right now with how all over the place I am, because I really, and I mentioned this a couple weeks ago on my channel, but like, I really, really want to start taking YouTube much more seriously. It's funny because when I randomly talk to people that have been watching my channel for a while, they're always like, it's crazy how many videos you put out and you know, all the subscribers and all that kind of stuff. And I'm just so bummed because I feel like there's so much potential for putting out a lot of YouTube content and good YouTube content. But I feel like I'm always torn with like what I want to be on my actual channel, because I constantly go back and forth between like, I want to vlog more, but then I forget in a busy day to vlog. And then I want to do gear reviews every once in a while, but I realize that ultimately I don't really love gear reviews. It's just not my favorite thing ever. So I kind of want to have a little bit of that, but I don't want it to be predictable on my channel. But I also have so many things that I do that I just don't know if anyone cares about it. And I've always been the person, I still am, that I'm kind of always just going to release whatever I feel like releasing. And if people like it, that's awesome. And if people don't, that's totally fine too. Because I just realized there's too many channels also that are so predictable that I feel like it's not even fun to follow, because you just know what they're going to upload. And I don't want to be a tech reviewer. I don't want to be a wedding cinematographer. I don't want to be just like a guy that gets people motivated. And like, I don't want to just be a business person. I want to be kind of a little bit of everything and share my whole life with people. And that's what I kind of want to do more of. And I realize that there are just, I think, too many channels out there that stay so specific, and that just doesn't seem super fun to me. So I feel like I'd rather it just be all over the place. The problem is I'm so all over the place that I just wonder if I'm hurting myself even trying to grow the channel by being so random. And I would love to know your thoughts on that. If you are obviously still listening to this podcast, your thoughts on predictable versus non-predictable when it comes to YouTube. Like, do you really love to know what to expect from each person? Or, to be honest, do you like kind of having things all over the place? Because the interesting thing about YouTube is that like 84% of my viewers that watch the 6 million or 7 million views that my channel has, 84% of them don't even subscribe to the channel. So there's this never-ending battle where it's like, if I make it exactly what I've done on my channel, but most of the subscribers don't watch it anyway, it doesn't really matter, because realistically, the better approach would be that you upload a lot of random things all the time, because you'll get different people to come across your videos that wouldn't by being outside of the normal. So like a video that I was gonna upload yesterday and I decided not to just because I wasn't happy with the video itself was gonna be like an ASMR style silent disc golf film where it was just like 9 holes of just the sounds of disc golf and throwing it and listening to the chains, and just so different than what's on my channel. And I still definitely am going to release that video, just not the one I did already, because I, number one, I played horrible, which was not fun. But I also think we could have just shot it a little better. We were kind of rushed, and I didn't want to go through all the work that we did that day, so we were kind of rushing it. I want to take it more seriously and take some time. So I want to do that. Then I'd like to start weekly series that is like maybe Mondays or Tuesdays or Fridays, whatever, where it's like a gear review day where we talk about gear, and then maybe another day where we talk about business and whatever, and then vlogs in the middle of that, but kind of just a little bit of everything, so that if you come across the channel and you like something, there's a little bit of everything possibly for you to see. So, but I am going back and forth all the time with what that looks like, because I do get sometimes frustrated because I want to put out so many more videos, and I realize at the end of the day, so often I'm just running out of time. And some of you may know, as I posted a couple weeks ago on the channel, I brought back on Ben, who was obviously in charge of really helping me with my content, and so that's kind of his main focus now. He is editing a little bit for Scaling Creative, so it's not entirely right now just my content, because of just some workload that we have to, you know, make sure that we get done. But I really, really want to take it seriously. So if you're listening to this video and or listening to this podcast or watching this video, and you think you could even provide some value and want to be a part of maybe even making that happen as well, and you're local, or maybe you're thinking about being more local, shoot me a DM. Maybe some internships could happen to take this to a whole nother level, because I really want to do more of it, and I would love to obviously have you a part of that. I'm drinking this fantastic beer called Victory Fest Beer, which is a lager, and it's just phenomenal beer. You can only get it certain times of the year, but it's so, so good. So sorry about that. So yeah, that's where I'm at with the YouTube channel. I hope some big things can happen soon, because I feel like I'm leaving lots of opportunities on the channel. I'm super thankful for the almost 60,000 subscribers that I have, but I feel like if I really, really, really took it seriously, we could do a lot more with it. Okay, so moving on. Let's talk a little bit about tech and gear, because everyone loves talking about gear. The Canon R5, R6, A7S III, Blackmagic 12K. What a crazy couple of weeks we've had of release information and rumors, and the cameras finally being announced, and then now they're kind of in the hands of some people, but not fully. Before I talk about this, I will say I pre-ordered one camera. It's the first camera I've ever pre-ordered in my life, actually. I won't tell you which camera it is. I'll tell you once I actually get it. But I did pre-order one camera, and I'm super excited about it. But let's talk about some cameras. So the big news was Canon first came out with the R5 and the R6. Now, Canon typically has been a company that tends to kind of be slower on releases and kind of go behind everybody and see what they're doing and then come out with cameras a little bit late. But they've always been super reliable, great color science, just great overall cameras that you knew you could trust. They did the interesting thing by releasing the R5 and the R6 way before anyone else did, before the A7S III and before the Blackmagic. They came out with the Canon R5, was the biggest announcement, which had 8K in this tiny body, 4K, 120 frames a second, and 240 frames a second in 1080. Just ridiculously impressive specs. Obviously, they were quickly plagued by, in a very interesting decision, in my opinion, overheating and the overheating woes that are cameras. Now, I say interesting because I think it's very, very different that Canon went this route. Canon has always been like ridiculously reliable and maybe slower and behind people with releases, but phenomenal cameras you can trust. Sony has typically been the company that, in my opinion, releases things so fast because they always want to be the first to release things, that they put these amazing specs in cameras and then they really can't even process them and they overheat and they're just not reliable. But they're like, yeah, that's okay because we're the first to do it. People will still get excited. And realistically, that's been the case. The original A7S, the A7S II, they had overheating issues. they had issues all the time that you had to worry about if you were recording in heat. But they were incredibly successful. So I was kind of thinking it would be kind of the same thing. I feel like when Canon finally released something new, that it would be ridiculously reliable. And it turns out that it's not entirely reliable. Now, obviously, there's lots of different videos I've seen about, like, is it really overheating? And does it overheat in 4K as well? Or is it just in 8K? Obviously, if you're shooting in 8K the entire time with these little bodies, I'd expect that it would have some heat issues. The 4K is the one that I would hope you didn't, because I'm shooting on the EOS R right now and I use this camera a ton and I can record in 4K as long as I want, never have overheating issues at all. And so I kind of was expecting, like, okay, maybe the R5 would have overheating issues in 8K, but at 4K, no way. Like, they've got to at least have that down. But turns out there's some overheating issues in general. So I don't have this camera in my hand, so I can't tell you anything about how it actually performs in real life thing, but from what I've seen, there are definitely issues. Now, can it be fixed in firmware? Is it giving you a warning before it actually needs to turn off? I don't really know, but we'll see. But regardless, on paper, the specs, ridiculous. 8K, 4K 120, 1080 and 240, a new autofocus system that was already really good. Just some pretty, pretty impressive specs, I will say. I'm pretty excited to actually see what this camera does when more people actually get it in their hands, because obviously it's all just kind of specs right now. You don't really know until people actually are using it. Then they simultaneously came out with the R6. The R6 was basically a little bit less specs, so no 8K, but it did 4K 60 and 120 frames a second in 1080. So they came out with the R6, and the R6, yes, 4K 60, 120 frames a second, 10-bit. But what they added to it that was a big deal for coming from someone that might have owned an EOS R is 5-axis image stabilization. Obviously, the EOS R, the biggest thing that it has had for a lot of people that they haven't loved is the fact that it doesn't have image stabilization. So when you're so used to cameras that have that, like we were, it's weird to get used to the EOS R because you don't have it. So them adding that was a big, big deal. And it'll just be interesting to see how that camera does, like who's it for. It's $2,500, so it's not incredibly cheap, but it's $1,300 cheaper than the R5, which is its, you know, big brother or big sister, whatever. So I have a feeling that they'll sell a lot more of the R6s personally because of the price point, and because from what I've seen, at least the R6 feels like it's maybe going to have less overheating issues because it doesn't have that monster 8K sensor. I don't really know, but both cameras, crazy impressive. And then the A7S III finally gets announced after all of this time. People have been waiting and waiting and waiting for this camera. It's been years since they released the A7S II. They finally release it right after Canon does theirs, of course. Really, really impressive specs. And so interestingly, Sony decides to keep it at 4K. They do 4K 20. They do the high frame rate in 1080. But they stop at 4K. And I say that's interesting because it's not that I think that you need 8K, because I honestly don't think you do right now. I think 4K still isn't even a standard, so it's still impressive. But it's a very interesting move from Sony, because Sony is always the ones that release crazy specs, whether they can handle it or not. And in this case, it's almost like they saw the R5 come out, and they saw all the people being like, 8K, wow, but then it overheats like crazy and people are like, okay, it's not as great as I want. I want a reliable camera. This is not going to replace my camera. And did Sony, like, not that I have any insider information, but I almost like wonder if they planned on putting an 8K sensor in and they just hadn't figured out exactly how to make it reliable yet. And when they finally realized that people were so crazy and how big of a deal people were making about the R5 overheating, did they say, you know what, let's just not put the 8K sensor in, let's do a 4K sensor, the one, maybe the one that they had already worked on or whatever. really high 4K 120, just like the R5, really high frame rate in 1080, just like the R5. But we can keep it from overheating because we don't have the same sensor that needs the 8K, whatever. Like, did they almost pull some of their initial thoughts when they saw the craziness that was the R5 release and people going crazy about, like, you've got to be kidding me, this thing can't handle the processor. I just wonder. I think that they might have. I think that maybe they waited and waited because they wanted to see what Canon was going to do. And when they saw the backlash that Canon was getting, even with the crazy impressive specs, because to me it felt like people were so blown away by the specs, but then actually it was overshadowed by people being so frustrated with reliability that people didn't actually care about that as much as they cared about it being reliable. So I don't know. Interesting to say the least. Then, right on the heels of everyone else relieving things, and actually before Sony released the A7S III, we got the Blackmagic 12K. Now, hold on. Let me make sure I get these specs too. This was a crazy, crazy camera. So, out of nowhere, Canon releases this 8K camera, and people are like, that's unbelievable, 8K, can you believe it? And then just out of nowhere, Blackmagic's like, yeah, it's not bad, but we're releasing the Blackmagic Ursa Mini Pro 12K, and it's going to do 12K 60, 8K 100 frames a second, 8K or 4K RAW at rates up to 110 frames a second without cropping, and 12K sensor. Like, just ridiculous. 4K 220. And just ridiculous. Oh, we didn't even talk about that with obviously the Canon R5 and A7S III. Obviously, they shoot RAW, which is, you know, crazy for a lot of people as well. So all those specs, and they also shoot RAW. So just pretty ridiculous cameras. So Blackmagic, though, out of nowhere releases this 12K, crazy specs, only $10,000, which I say only because that's actually a good price for how crazy the camera actually is. I don't know who it's exactly for or who is their target. I feel like Blackmagic's always this interesting company to me that makes really good products, but they're like, they almost have like their own fanboys, but they don't have like mass market, but maybe that's what they're okay with. I don't know. It's interesting, but pretty impressive cameras. No question about it. It always brings up the question, which is partially what I talked about with my GH5 video that I did, all about, is the GH5 still relevant? Like, what camera am I going to buy, and am I going to buy a new camera? I always have kind of tried my best to not go crazy with needing to buy a new camera as soon as it comes out every single time, because I realize that if you nonstop chase the newest gear, you can never be happy with what you have because the gear just never stops coming out. So I kind of really evaluated and looked at and said, what do I have right now? Which is the C200. I got 4K 60. I got 120 frames in 1080. I got a really usable 8-bit codec in 4K when I want to do the everyday stuff that I do all the time. But I also have RAW available 12-bit when I really want to take things to another level with certain shoots. I got dual SD card slots, which are affordable media, which I really, really love. And then RAW and CFast, which is not as affordable, but still usable. Great autofocus, great low light, great dynamic range and log. I kind of looked at it and said, like, I really have what I still need for the next 3 years at least of shooting. And for the price point of the C200 being dropped to $5,500, I just feel like it's a phenomenal, phenomenal camera. Like, it really is outstanding, and I've been so happy with it. Is it the camera for everybody? No, but it's definitely the camera that I love, and I felt strong enough about it that I felt like, even though it's 2 years old and even though lots of things are coming out, what I think is most important is reliability, unlimited recording time, great autofocus, all those things. And the C200 is just in a level of its own, in my opinion, still, even comparing to like the R5 and the A7S3 and that, because you have ridiculously good battery life, still great autofocus, unlimited recording time, never worrying about overheating. I've shot for multiple hours outside at a time, never an issue. It's just incredibly, incredibly reliable, and I love it. So I bought a third one. That's my rigs. I might actually finally be selling the GH5 rig just because I feel like I'm going to use it so little that I may be building a secondary rig that I can utilize for when I really don't want the C200s for some reason, if they're too big. Haven't decided exactly what that is, but more details will follow on that in the coming weeks. But it's kind of where I'm at. Like, I feel like the C200s, three of them are our main rigs, and they've been outstanding. I'd rather spend more money on more audio and more lighting and more just getting better at what I use, because I know the C200s are so unbelievably capable of everything I'm going to throw at it over the next bunch of years, that I'm just going to use them and use them really, really well and be okay with them. So, yeah. So that's kind of the tech world right now, or the camera world, I should say. Some other cool tech that came out recently, Flight Simulator 2020 came out. It's just super weird, but like ever since I was young, like 10 years old, I always loved Flight Simulator games. And I used to live across the street from a guy that had Flight Simulator when I was maybe 8 to 12 years old. And the guy had Flight Simulator, and he had like the at-home rig that you could really fly and feel like you're flying. And I used to, every single time he got home from work, I would try to like run over to his house before he got out of his car and ask if I could play. And he rarely let me play because or my parents usually didn't always like let me go over there and ask, because they knew that I was probably annoying him. But I always thought it was super fun. And then now the new Flight Simulator comes out, looks unbelievable. I don't have a PC. Like, I only have Macs, and they don't have Flight Simulator for the Mac. So I'm super torn, because I really want to play that game. And I feel like realistically it's probably stupid regardless, because I don't have time to play games and I probably would just waste time playing it. So I probably shouldn't get it anyway, but I really want to get it. Really want to get it. It looks super cool. Am I the only nerd that loves like that kind of game? Just is so impressive what they're able to do. I don't know. Some other cool tech, the Galaxy Fold came out. I'm not a huge fan of Samsung at all. Personally, I just think that I don't really like the phones they make, but I love the concept of that phone. The idea of having a little phone that opens up to a bigger tablet that you can use, I think is cool. As someone who's a huge fan of the iPad Pro, I like the idea of having like a 2-in-1 device, but I will say that like I don't really know if it would replace a tablet for me. That's one other thing. For what I use the iPad for and for the size that it is and how often I use it, I don't really feel like the folds would replace that anyway. And I'm saying fold, but like if Apple came out with a foldable phone that went from, let's say, the 5 inches that it is now to a 10-inch tablet, would I use it? I don't really know. I feel like the foldable is definitely the way that everybody's going. I'm just so curious how reliability is with these things. How they make glass folds and keep it reliable. That just seems crazy to me. Like we live in such a crazy tech world right now. It's unbelievable. We're so lucky and we complain about tech all the time. Crazy. We're living in crazy, crazy times. Anyway, that's it for today. Let's not go on too much longer. I just want to get this podcast up and going again. I would love to know, for those who are listening to this, what you thought. And most importantly, kind of what you'd like to see from the podcast. I definitely want to bring some more tech conversation in, some more stuff that's kind of talking some business, a little bit of everything. But just like my YouTube channel, I kind of want this podcast to be a little bit unpredictable, but always predictable that there'd be some value that you can get from it. So we'd love to know your thoughts, though. I appreciate you listening. And if you have people that you think that I should interview on the podcast, let's definitely keep that conversation open as well, because I definitely want to bring a lot more people on the podcast. That's something I'm absolutely going to do. So that's kind of where I'm at right now. But I appreciate you listening as always. Make sure you shoot me a DM somewhere. Twitter or Instagram, wherever you prefer is usually the easiest place to send me a direct message. And just let me know if you're actually still listening to this podcast 46 minutes in or 45 minutes, whatever it is. You are special, and I'd love to know who you are. So make sure that you reach out to me. Tell me you listened to the whole thing. And, yeah, let's keep making this happen. I appreciate you being here, and thanks for listening. Talk to you guys real soon. I promise. See ya.